Hi, my name is Dave Hooper. I want to tell you a story that began with an innocent question. Back when I was just a regular guy, I'd been a career entrepreneur with some successes and failures. In other words, by this point in my life, I'd been humbled. But we were okay financially, my wife had another son on the way, and life was pretty good. That was February of 2011, which was the last normal month I'd ever have. That's when I first took a closer look at 9/11 and found something astonishing, something that would change my life. This is the story of how one simple accidental question came to be and how it led to another and then another, becoming a research obsession that crashed my belief system and drove my marriage, relationships, and sanity to the brink of disaster, and how out from that brink came my awakening. You can't write or talk about it. You just have to see it to believe it. And that's why this film was born. So let's start at the beginning, when my eyes first opened. Looking into 9/11 by itself didn't bring on this spiritual awakening, but it was the first domino to fall. You're about to get a peek down the rabbit hole, but just a peek, just enough to see that there is one. So get ready, because you're going to see some things that will test your beliefs and your notion of reality. So why don't we ease into it? Because you know what it's like when you first open your eyes after a deep sleep. That first light can be intense. My awakening began with a simple question. It occurred as I watched a familiar clip of President Bush on the morning of 9/11. I didn't realize it then, but this question was about to change my life. Bush is sitting at Booker Elementary School in Sarasota, Florida at 9:05 a.m. when White House Chief of Staff Andrew Card whispers into the president's ear.
A second plane has hit the second tower. America is under attack.
That first question was, why didn't the Secret Service get him out of there immediately? They didn't know how many planes were hijacked yet or what their targets were.
There were actually 8 planes that were hijacked.
We had 11 reports of hijacked aircraft.
There were thousands of planes still flying. As many as a dozen planes were reported hijacked at one point. And it was no secret the president was there. The school visit had been made public on September 7th, 4 days prior to 9/11. How could anyone be so sure hijackers weren't already on the way? Yet there he lingered, even after 2 more flights were confirmed hijacked, Flight 77 and Flight 93, the Pentagon and Shanksville planes respectively. Somewhere I saw a story claiming the president's camp didn't want to scare the kids at the school, and that's why he stayed, which I found hard to believe. Well-trained professionals are going to risk the balance of power in the world to spare the feelings of a few kids who routinely practice fire drills anyway? Well, I guess the answer was yes, because Bush stayed until 9:34 a.m., a full 29 minutes after it was known we were under attack. Think about that. That would have been 29 grueling minutes for everyone, especially those assigned to protect the president, wondering if some hijackers gotten ambitious, maybe changed their plans in the last few days after the school visit was made public. I guess someone high up in the president's camp must have known or thought they were safe. I mean, what else could it be? But how could anyone have known that? It had me thinking, but it wasn't a huge deal. I was more intrigued by the type of people I came across who also had similar questions about 9/11. These weren't conspiracy theorists as I pictured them. These were people in government, aviation, civil defense, architecture, science, engineering, and the military. I decided to look further. I still had no idea the impact this would have on my life. I started by refamiliarizing myself with the incident, or I should say set of incidents. Of course, we all remember the second tower being hit, but I didn't put much thought into the other parts of that day. And soon after looking, I was reminded that there were several incredible events on 9/11. I'd put almost no thought into the particulars of that day for 10 years, but that was about to change. In chronological order, the official version goes like this. 4 planes were hijacked by 19 mostly Saudi Arabian terrorists who then flew or attempted to fly those planes into 4 U.S. buildings, World Trade Center 1, World Trade Center 2, the Pentagon, and the U.S. Capitol. 3 of them were successful. American Airlines Flight 11 hit the first tower, the North Tower, at 8:46 a.m. United Airlines Flight 175 hit the South Tower at 9:03 a.m. American Airlines Flight 77 hit the Pentagon at 9:37 a.m. At 9:59, the South Tower collapsed after burning for less than an hour. At 10.07 a.m., United Flight 93 crashed in a field in Shanksville, Pennsylvania. Then at 10.28 a.m., the North Tower collapsed. And I barely remembered that a third building at the World Trade Center, Building 7, collapsed at 5.20 p.m. to close out the day. The National Institute of Standards and Technology, more commonly known as NIST, backed up the official government version that intense fires weakened the steel and caused all three buildings to fail, including Building 7, which, oddly enough, was not hit by an airplane, nor was it exposed to jet fuel, which is what I thought melted the towers to get that progressive collapse started.
And you had that intense heat probably weaken the structure as well.
As I looked for answers, I found Shyam Sunder of NIST stating, "The buildings were not brought down by explosives." Until then, I didn't know explosives were even in the conversation. And like hearing a child claim innocence before a question is even posed, it had my eyebrow raised.
World Trade Center 7 collapsed because of fires fueled by office furnishings. It did not collapse from explosives or from fuel oil fires.
While researching the official government story, I saw a news flash that the 9/11 families wanted an investigation of World Trade Center 7. I was a bit surprised. Why would they be questioning the official story? That seemed a little out there, but who could be more invested than they were? So I listened to what they had to say.
Our perception of what happened on September 11th is very different from the general public's perception, I'd say, for the most part.
I believe that the public is still uninformed about most of the issues that are surrounding them.
I just don't think the public at all knows. They want to believe.
I think the truth sometimes can be frightening.
There's some deep, deep explaining to do.
The bottom line is that it needs to be investigated.
We have to demand a new investigation. I want justice here.
Nobody ever stopped to have a scientific investigation. A scientific investigation. A scientific.
What did these families know that I didn't? It's obvious once you look, they've been trying to say something is wrong, and we need to look at 9/11 more closely, especially Building 7. And they weren't alone. I found an endless sea of organizations, rallies, websites, books, and films about that day, but I never really heard about any of them on the evening news. The families and many others were pointing to World Trade Center Building 7, the last one to collapse. I wanted to research what was so special about Building 7. We were only a few days away from launching my new business when I shared with Betsy that I didn't think there was any harm in pushing it back a bit so I could look into Building 7 for myself. This news, combined with the controversial nature of what I was looking into, was met with less than enthusiastic support by my wife, even though she tried to hide it. It was understandable. Remember, our baby was due in a few months, and I was suggesting changes, but they weren't too big and she was okay with it, so I moved forward. And that's how it began. I didn't know it then, but I set us on a course that would lead our marriage to the brink of disaster. But that hadn't happened yet, so let's pick this back up at Building 7. Here are some basic facts. World Trade Center 7, which was located in downtown New York City, is sometimes called the Solomon Brothers Building, but is most commonly referred to as Building 7. With construction beginning in 1984, it benefited from many modern advancements in building technology. It was a 47-story, steel-framed, fireproof skyscraper standing 550 feet tall. It was 300 feet from the nearest tower, the North Tower, or about a football field away. Even though it was one of the largest buildings in Manhattan, it looked small next to the Twin Towers. In September of 2001, Building 7 would have been the tallest building in 33 states. It collapsed at 5:20 p.m. the afternoon of September 11th. Even though Building 7 was not hit by an airplane, the official explanation for all three buildings that collapsed was that intense fires weakened the steel, resulting in total symmetrical building failure. The official story goes on to state that in Building 7, Column 79 gave out first, starting a progressive failure of the remaining columns, which allowed the building to fall almost as fast as a bowling ball would, into its own footprint. If a building that size accidentally collapsed on any other day, it would have been as famous as the Titanic sinking. Yet according to a 2006 Zogby poll, 43% of Americans never even heard of Building 7. Building 7 housed the CIA's largest station outside of Washington, D.C. It also contained the Secret Service's biggest field office. The IRS, Department of Defense, and the SEC also occupied entire floors. The mayor's emergency management bunker was located in the building, but ironically, it wasn't used that day. The rest of the tenants were primarily banks such as Solomon Smith Barney, which occupied the top 17 floors. Many government and SEC documents for cases primarily against Wall Street banks, but also including WorldCom and Enron, were destroyed, crippling the investigation into thousands of cases. At this point, I didn't think anything was too far out of place. I'd come across a few strange things, but I wasn't thinking conspiracy or anything like that. I did, however, find it a little odd that falling debris could set off a chain of events, ultimately turning Building 7 into a pile of rubble. However, I really didn't understand the physics involved, at least not yet. But I didn't need to understand physics to find it pretty strange that the whole building would crash through itself. I've played with Legos. Tip over? Maybe. But to pile drive through itself didn't make sense. At least the Twin Towers were hit by planes, but no plane hit Building 7. Sometimes it's easier for me to tackle complex issues with simple metaphors. So I thought of a stove. Then I imagined what kind of materials would I need to add to the fire so that all four legs would collapse simultaneously. And I couldn't answer it. Better yet, let's say I stacked 10 stoves on top of each other, and then I welded them together to better represent any of the buildings that collapsed that day. Now I go and light, let's say, the 7th stove up on the stack. What could cause the 7th stove's legs to give out simultaneously and cause every other stove below it and above it to break apart into tiny pieces, crashing to a pile of rubble in a few seconds? And how could that happen 3 times in a row? After breaking it down, I felt a little pit in my stomach for the first time, but I assured myself that I must be missing something. With that said, it was time to take a crash course in high-rise fires. It seems that high-rise fires are more common than I thought. I found hundreds of them. According to a 2011 report by the National Fire Protection Association, there are an average of 110 fires each year in buildings over 13 stories tall. According to the report, between 2005 and 2009, there were 550 high-rise fires. Of course, there are many more all throughout history, but let's talk about some of the more startling ones. Sao Paulo, Brazil, the Yoelma building, 1974. Sparked by an electrical fire, the residential building burned twice as long as the Twin Towers, yet it stood. The underlying structure wasn't even weakened. In fact, it's still in use today. The MGM Grand, which is now Bally's in Las Vegas, Nevada, caught fire in 1980, killing 85 people. It's had a few facelifts and ownership changes, but the structure underneath was never compromised. It's still in use today. Los Angeles, California, 1988. What was then called the first interstate bank building burned for 3.5 hours. No structural failure at all. In fact, an insurance company moved in, and today it's known as the Aon Center. In 2004, the Parque Central building in Caracas, Venezuela, the country's tallest building, burned for 17 hours. The facade was repaired, and it is in use today. Philadelphia, Pennsylvania, One Meridian Plaza, 1991, burned for 18 hours. It stood. Beijing, China, the Mandarin Oriental Hotel, burned for 6 hours in 2009. It stood. Chechnya's tallest building burned for 7 hours in April 2013. It stood. Dubai, Moscow, Zurich, and on. I was starting to see a trend. Fires don't melt steel or cause buildings to collapse. The World Trade Center has itself burned many times with no structural failure or weakening. Some significant dates include February 13, 1975, when the 9th to the 14th floors burned for 3 hours. No damage or weakening of the structure was recorded.
The fire began in an electrical wiring closet on the 11th floor. Some fire department officials and building officials here say that there's no chance the World Trade Center could become a type of towering inferno.
And in 1993, it survived a bomb detonated in a highly vulnerable area with no structural damage caused by the fires that resulted from the explosion. There was, of course, damage from the bomb, which had to be repaired. But through it all, the towers have always stood. Sometimes buildings do collapse because of structural failure, but it's usually a design problem or earthquake damage or a controlled demolition. Buildings don't come down because of fire, but when they do collapse, they tend to tip over and stay connected. After reviewing hundreds of fires, I could find only three occurrences of fire bringing down a steel-framed high-rise in all of history. And all three were on 9/11.
High-rise buildings simply do not collapse due to fire.
Collapse of World Trade Center 7 was primarily due to fire.
But there's a problem. Office and open-air jet fuel fires cannot melt steel.
A lot of things in these kind of buildings have to be fire-resistant by nature. It's required by code. So there really isn't a whole lot of fuel in there to begin with.
The National Institute of Standards and Technology said that the maximum air temperatures was about 1,800 degrees or 1,000 degrees colder than what's needed to melt steel.
And it takes a blast furnace with air blowing with blowers to try to get steel to melt.
So if you have a flame at 750 degrees, you can hold that flame under a steel beam forever, and you'll never reach a high enough temperature to bend steel, let alone melt it.
This would have us to believe that these were was a typical office fire, scattered office fires, if you will, that brought this building down. Since the mid-60s, I've tried to follow high-rise fires, and I'm not aware of any high-rise building that have come down as a result of fires.
And seeing black smoke come out the windows, that means that the fires were oxygen-starved.
Kerosene would have burned off very quickly. What wasn't destroyed in the initial fireball would have been consumed fairly rapidly and would have only really served as an ignition for the rest of the material.
None of which would have been, in my experience as a fire protection engineer, hot enough to sufficiently soften the steel or damage the steel to result in a total collapse of the building.
Well, we're told that the planes hit the buildings and there was an explosion and a fire, and about an hour and a half later, in the case of the North Tower, the buildings collapsed due to structural weakening due to the fires. Fires in high-rises have never brought down a steel frame of high-rise building at all, ever.
The bottom line is this. Steel-framed high-rises don't collapse, especially into their own footprint, because of fire. This is why builders and architects have loved steel for 100 years. A fire typically can't compromise the steel structure. Of course, 9/11 was not a typical day with typical fires. Jet fuel was involved. But the kerosene, or the jet fuel, just can't explain it. Set aside for a minute that only two of the buildings were subjected to kerosene. Now think of a kerosene lamp or a kerosene heater. In the history of kerosene lamps, I have never heard of one being melted because the fires were too hot. In fact, the World Trade Center fires were starved of oxygen and therefore heat. You can see it in the black smoke coming from the towers. Yet molten iron was found in the rubble of all three buildings. Something else had to provide the heat and energy needed to liquefy, melt, or even microscopically bend the steel in any of those three buildings. And unless you work for NIST, scientists agree that neither jet fuel, nor the fuel, nor the furnishings inside those buildings could have heated the steel enough to melt it. I was starting to realize that something else must have been involved in the collapse of at least Building 7, if not all three. Okay, maybe airplanes weakened the structure of the Twin Towers, which we'll be looking into more deeply later. For now, believe it or not, planes have hit many buildings throughout history and none fell. Of course, none were hit with planes as large as the ones on 9/11, but that still leaves Building 7. I couldn't explain it. Can you tell me that if I throw a flaming chunk of metal off of one building, I can make the building next to it collapse in on itself a few hours later? Why do demolition companies even exist if you can just light a few random fires and wait for an implosion? Maybe the steel structure in Building 7 was so badly damaged from falling debris that the entire structure was compromised. It still can't explain the symmetrical collapse, but I looked anyway. Other buildings that have suffered severe structural damage by natural disaster or bombs didn't disintegrate into rubble piles. They stayed together in some way. Even the buildings in the Trade Center complex that suffered worse damage than Building 7 didn't collapse in on themselves. This uneasy feeling was growing, but there was much more to understand about Building 7's collapse, especially before I started jumping to conclusions in my own head. I needed to hear from some experts.
It just didn't add up, the way the whole thing sort of pile drove itself into the ground and all at near free fall speed.
Collapses straight down into its own footprint at free fall speed. This is uncanny. There's 40,000 tons of structural steel designed to resist this collapse.
This building had 40,000 tons of structural steel in its structural system, and that is intended to keep it from going anywhere.
Yeah, animation sequence from the National Institute of Standards and Technology for their model, their mathematical model of the collapse of building number 7. And they have the inside members that one column gave way, which they claim resulted in the collapse of all the surrounding members, and then this precipitated a global collapse. This would just would not be physically possible for a gravitational collapse.
According to NIST, the failure occurred at column 79 on level 12. This means, basically, they're talking about a single columnar collapse or failure that resulted in a total collapse of the building. That just does not make any sense. Regardless of the engineering, the logic tells you that if you have a single failure at some random point in the building, that the entire building is not going to collapse. Buildings don't break that way.
The story that just a few columns can cause a synchronized global collapse, an implosion, is, well, that's just nonsense.
The exterior columns on the outside, as well as on the inside, at the bottom would have to be severed almost at the same time.
The building would want to topple over. It would want to bend over over that weakened area and topple over sideways. What we saw was, we saw the structures came straight down upon itself.
It cannot happen that when you have asymmetric damage, you will get a perfectly symmetrical collapse.
At free fall speed. That's impossible. That's a violation of the fundamental law of physics that says that for every action, there's an equal and opposite reaction.
If you took a billiard ball and dropped at the height of the Twin Towers, and you just merely stopped it and started it every floor in free fall, it would take over a minute and a half to reach the ground. The buildings were down in 10 seconds.
Buildings just don't behave like that. If floors fall, they tend to fall and are braced by the floor directly beneath it. And there's some delay there. And then the next floor falls with two floors, and there's some more delay.
The buildings actually accelerated as they came down, meaning they were not getting resistance from these massive columns in the center of the core of this building. And when it's all finished, the outside walls from the lower floors are piled one on top of the other right in the middle of the building.
So it's fiction to say that a building as modern as World Trade Center 7 comes down with no resistance.
Doesn't add up.
The official explanation was dead wrong.
Just not possible.
Not possible.
Just doesn't make sense. It's not how it works.
It can't happen.
Never before in history.
It just can't happen. Well, that's just nonsense.
And that cannot happen.
Couldn't happen.
It's fiction.
There's definitely much more going on than just fire.
This was a controlled event.
The symmetry is the smoking gun.
In short, the evidence is clear. We are witnessing not the collapse of a building, but its demolition.
At the time, I was thinking, wait a minute. My heart was pounding, my adrenaline was flowing, and I had a knot in my stomach. You know, the collapse never looked right to me, but then again, I never really thought that it defied the laws of physics. My imagination started to run wild.
Could the hijackers have wired the buildings? Maybe the government didn't want us to know how really lax their security was, and that's why they covered up this fact. Maybe it was pre-wired for some reason, but that made no sense. If it was a controlled demolition, it would explain how much of these buildings were reduced to ash. It would explain why the towers fell after burning for only an hour or so. It would explain why they imploded instead of tearing apart. It would explain why they all fell at close to free fall speed. It sure looked like a controlled demolition, in retrospect. I couldn't stop at this point. I needed to know more. Late nights, coffee, research. My life was changing before my very eyes. I had taken my very first step down the rabbit hole. Little did I know how much deeper it would go. By now I knew that fires didn't bring down the buildings. And even if fire could somehow melt steel, the buildings would not have fallen in on themselves. They would have tipped over, torn apart. I was starting to find credible people talking about controlled demolitions and the use of explosives and molten steel. My mind kept wandering, trying to imagine how all this tied together. But first, I still needed to understand more about what happened.
And what we find down there is pools of molten iron.
What does that mean?
Several tons. Exactly. What is that doing there? The first responders see it. The structural engineers see it. It's documented by FEMA, the melting of steel. Normal office fires is what's supposed to have brought these buildings down, along with jet plane impacts. The jet fuel and office fires don't produce molten iron or molten steel. It doesn't begin to melt until 3,000 degrees.
At one point, I think there were about 2,800 degrees.
See the stuff he's pulling out?
Yeah.
Red hot.
8 weeks later, we still got fires burning.
The concept of molten iron is very important here. In order to get molten iron, you have to reach unbelievable heat levels. It takes much, much more energy than you could find with any combination of burning office furniture, jet fuel, or gravity. Molten iron can be an indication of the use of thermite. Thermite, thermate, and nanothermite are super hot burning substances used by the military that can cut through steel. It can supply its own oxygen so it can burn underwater. It would explain how fires burned at ground zero for 3 months even after the area was flooded.
So thermite would also explain potentially the fact that the fires could not be put out at ground zero. The fires lasted for quite a while.
The fires were finally put out on December 13, 2001, just over 3 months after 9/11, making it the longest burning building fire in recorded history. They burned underwater for much of that time. These fires were a big question mark. But first, it was time to take a closer look at NIST. They are the scientific agency backing the official version of events as most Americans know them. I was hoping they would curb my growing anxiety. Instead, what I learned about NIST made my heart sink. To understand NIST, you need to understand their relationship to explosives. They have vehemently denied that there were any. Not only do they not check for them, they state that none were used, plain and simple. In fact, they have gone to unbelievable lengths to prove that explosives, or even the evidence of explosives, like pops going off, did not exist. Some people might call it incompetence. Others might call it selling your soul.
NIST concedes that they found no evidence for explosives. So then we asked them, well, did you look? And they said, no, we did not look for explosives or residues of explosives.
So the preconceived notion of NIST is that there's no evidence for explosives, and so there's no point in looking. That is the most unscientific thing that you can possibly think of, not to look because you don't expect to find evidence, and in fact, the evidence is overwhelming.
NIST computed what they claimed would be the minimum loudness of an explosion that could sever column 79 with a single blast. Then they claimed no observers detected explosions as loud as their predictions.
This size blast would have produced an incredibly loud sound that was not recorded on videos of the collapse, nor reported by witnesses.
On the basis of this artificial threshold of interest, they swept aside all evidence of actual explosions and concluded that no explosives contributed to the destruction of the building.
We did not find any evidence that explosives were used in the collapse.
Is that a secondary explosion?
Yes, it was.
Definitely
a secondary explosion.
Secondary explosions, sometimes described as pops or booms, are mini detonations apart from the primary explosion of the plane impacts. These types of explosions are routine in a controlled demolition. They were heard in all three buildings long before any collapsed.
Like, it sounded like gunfire, you know, bang, 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 and then all of a sudden, three big explosions.
That sound was not picked up by any of the videos or witnesses that we have talked to.
You heard explosions, like, ba-boom!
We just heard one more explosion. That's about the fourth one we've heard.
CNN is now reporting that there was a third explosion at the World Trade Center.
Equally unempirical is the treatment by NIST and Poplin Mechanics of reports of explosions before and during the collapses. Both documents pretend that there were no explosions.
Secondary explosion. We've got numerous people covered with dust from the secondary explosion.
Okay, you get the point. Why was NIST denying these explosions? Why are they a big deal? Well, those explosions are a strong sign of a controlled demolition, but they're not proof positive of one. If it was a controlled demolition, there would be other signs like misfired explosives and particles in the dust.
So their preferred method of dealing with this problem was to ignore or even deny the reports. John Gross, one of the chief authors of the NIST report, was captured on film while he was making a public presentation, saying that he knew of absolutely no eyewitness who has said there was a pool of molten steel.
I'm curious about the pool of molten steel that was found in the bottom of the towers.
First of all, let's go back to your basic premise that there was a pool of molten steel. I know absolutely nobody, no eyewitness who said so.
Get down below and see molten steel. Molten steel running down the channel rails. Like you're in a foundry.
Like lava from a volcano.
The fires got very intense down there, and it actually melted beams where it was molten steel that was being dug out.
Underground, it was still so hot that molten metal dripped down the sides of the wall from Building 6.
The premise that there was a pool of molten steel. I know of absolutely nobody, no eyewitness who said so, nobody who produced it. I was on the site, I was on the steel yards, so I don't know that that's so.
Then I was at the site 2 weeks after it happened with Governor Pataki, right? And they had to cease digging that day. You know why? They were finding pockets of molten liquid metal.
In an office fire, you cannot generate enough heat to melt steel. And yet we have evidence of molten iron in the microspheres, in the rubble pile, and the metal pouring out of the side of the tower.
About 7 minutes before its final destruction, almost an hour after the plane hit, molten metal was seen coming out of the northeast corner near the 80th floor.
What was going on here? These guys at NIST are the official version. Office and jet fuel fires can reach about 1,600 degrees under ideal conditions, but NIST said that the fires burned at 1,800 degrees, which they claim was just enough to weaken and bend the steel, which led to complete failure of each building's infrastructure. But that still leaves us more than 1,000 degrees short of molten metal, which was found all over Ground Zero. They denied that molten metal existed, and they denied that witnesses heard secondary explosions going off. Even the NIST computer animation of Building 7's collapse is inaccurate, showing the outer structural walls crumpling in instead of coming straight down.
The NIST report on which popular mechanics and much of the press has relied is not a scientific report. It is a political document.
We need to have an investigation of NIST themselves. I believe that the reports that came out are not true.
So the fact that NIST says that is absolutely, in my opinion, it's criminal.
NIST wasn't looking for the truth. They were trying to hide it. But why? Were they asked to falsify their findings? I didn't think they came up with this on their own. When I see John Gross fidget and blush as he states there was no molten metal, I see a man that is doing what many of us do when we don't tell the truth. It's basic human nature. My feelings at the time were like the moment you catch your significant other in a lie. Maybe there's an explanation, but your heart is racing until you get some answers. And if something like that's ever happened to you, you may understand needing to know more, but not wanting to know more, if that makes sense. Was there more evidence of a controlled demolitions besides explosions? And where did the molten metal come from? I needed more before I could get my head around this. I took a deeper look into all the buildings, the airplane strikes, and the possibility of planted explosives. Mostly, I was looking for something to explain away this growing pile of problems. I was looking for answers that could reduce my growing anxiety. Instead, I would fall further down the rabbit hole. By now, Betsy was about to give birth. The idea of putting the business off for a week had turned into a few months, and I couldn't help from talking about my findings all the time, even though Betsy asked me to tone it down. She needed more from me as a husband and father, and I needed more from her to preserve my sanity. Then my dad died, and 8 days later, my son was born. I was all over the place. This prompted my first break. I was in a very strange place, grieving my dad and celebrating my son, while digesting this new information that no one wanted to discuss. What I'd been working on was no secret to my whole family, and everyone seemed pretty relieved when it looked like I was re-entering my normal life. I was enjoying the family and starting to talk about business again, which made Betsy happy. And I wasn't talking about 9/11 anymore, which made Betsy even happier. But just when things were getting back to normal, I started getting a feeling, an urge to get back into it. It kept growing and I couldn't explain why I had it. I tried to ignore it, but I couldn't. And like an addict that fell off the wagon, I was back at it like I'd never left. I still wasn't certain what brought down Building 7, but I was pretty sure it wasn't fire. And it certainly wasn't an airplane, since it wasn't hit by one. Maybe a look at the Twin Towers could shed some light on this.
Most skyscrapers are built on steel or concrete frames, which is a grid of columns and beams that goes all the way through the building. The World Trade Center was different. It was what engineers call a tube structure. It was a very, very strong mesh of steel.
There's a large central rectangle in each of the towers that contained 47 columns, and these columns basically were the primary structural support of the building.
These 47, 48 columns are essentially the superstructure of a battleship. They're essentially a suspension bridge. There's no way that burning kerosene can ever affect these in the least, if only because of the radiator effect.
The minuscule possibility that fire somehow brought all three buildings down was gone. My only hope was that airplanes could have destabilized the buildings somehow. It didn't explain Building 7, but I was trying to give the official version every possible chance to be right. Let's look at the best documented impact that day. At 9:03 a.m., United Flight 175 hit the South Tower. The majority of the jet fuel burned off in the initial explosion, but maybe there was an explanation for the collapse in the plane impacts themselves. The first interview I came across was a Frank DeMartini, the construction manager of the World Trade Center.
The building was designed to have a fully loaded 707 crash into it. That was the largest plane at the time. The building probably could sustain multiple impacts of jetliners because this structure is like the mosquito netting on your screen door. The jet plane is just a pencil puncturing that screen netting. It really does nothing to the screen netting.
But the largest aircraft flying today, at least commercially, the 747 fully loaded, is on the order of 300 tons. So if you think about a 300-ton element crashing into a building that's been designed to carry 13,000 tons, you can see that an aircraft crashing into the World Trade Center would probably not do anything.
We designed the buildings to take the impact of the Boeing 707 hitting the building at any location.
But the plane had already hit. And what I noticed was the lights were still on in the lobby. That led me to believe that the plane never got to the core columns, because the seeds for all these transformers feeding all the light and power in the towers were adjacent to the core columns.
Those aircraft and those fires could not cause those buildings to come down in that way.
The idea that airplanes could have destabilized the buildings never made much sense to me. The Twin Towers were like a solid iron rod coming out of the ground, supported by another steel building surrounding it. Let's use another metaphor to clarify what I mean. Let's assume a stop sign is like one of the towers. The post is the core and the thin shield of the sign is the Trade Center's outer mesh. If you shot a bullet through the stop sign, the bullet would go through the outer shell and the inner steel core that holds it up. Is the structure weakened after the event? Is it possible for the sign to implode in on itself, partially turning to dust? Does it matter if it was a flaming bullet that exploded on impact? Could the sign ever collapse in on itself? The plane impact still can't explain the near free fall speed of all three collapses, but I had to look. So if it wasn't fire and it wasn't airplanes, then it wasn't natural. Maybe I needed to look for things that can make something like this happen. And holding off on the who and the why, for now. One step at a time.
And it's my expert opinion. As a demolition expert, I was trained by the best the U.S. government has. I served 3 years on underwater demolition team 12. 2 years I was attached to SEAL team 1. And when I look at the buildings and how they fall and the way they fell, they couldn't have come down without being assisted in some manner.
The only way that a building can accelerate as it collapses is by having pre-engineered, precisely timed, and precisely placed explosives. In other words, controlled demolition.
The collapse of the building was caused by controlled demolition.
In fact, the evidence shows very strongly
that there were explosives used in the way the buildings came down.
We started running, floor by floor, it started popping out.
It was like, it was if it had detonated.
Detonated.
They were planning to take down a building. Boom, 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 boom.
All the way down.
Explosives are used to demolish buildings like this in just seconds. Okay, so it's a controlled demolition. What's the problem with that? Let's just think about this. Controlled demolitions cannot be engineered and rigged in a day. It takes months. And therefore, this event must have been planned in advance.
Controlled demolition is used to bring unwanted buildings neatly down into their own footprint. It's part science and part art. Through the placement and synchronization of many different types of explosives, demolition companies can control how and when any building falls. Some are brought down or pulled in a plain Jane fashion, and others as a pyrotechnic show for an active audience. There are many more, but let's look at 8 typical signs of controlled demolition. We've already covered a few of them. We know the buildings fell at near free fall speed and the collapses were symmetrical. Anyone can see that with the naked eye. We already established people heard explosions, but it was confusing to me. And of course you're going to hear loud noises as a building collapses. This needed further investigation. By now I was only going to trust my own eyes when it came to researching 9/11. I think it's too important an event to let someone else tell you what to believe about it. But I'm getting ahead of myself. There are 118 documented testimonies of explosions heard from firemen and other first responders alone, which took a court order to be released, and that doesn't include the maintenance employees or regular tower workers. After analyzing locations and timestamps, I broke explosions into 3 categories. Impact synchronized booms were explosions seemingly timed with the plane strikes in the seconds before and after the collisions. Pre-collapse pops were explosions heard all over the buildings from the time of the first plane impact until Building 7 fell. The final booms and crackle are the main body of explosives, which are detonated over the span of a few seconds, leading up to and through the collapse. It seems that explosives went off in different parts of the Trade Center when each plane hit. William Rodriguez, a 20-year maintenance employee of the Trade Center who was decorated for saving many people that day, was in the building when the first plane hit. Let's hear what he and a few others had to say about a subterranean explosion coinciding with the first plane hit.
It was a huge explosion that came from under my feet, meaning that it came from the sub-levels between B2 and B3. And then there was a huge explosion at the top of the building. You could hear the difference from the bottom and all the way through the top.
They were having coffee in the World Trade Center when the first plane struck.
And all of a sudden it sounded like, I don't know where the subway is, but it sounded like a subway collision, a bomb.
Just got out of the tunnel and it blew.
The subway tunnel?
Yeah.
Yes, I was right there. I was down in the basement, came down, all of a sudden the elevator blew up, smoke. I dragged the guy out, his skin was hanging off, and I dragged him out and I helped him out to the ambulance.
What that man is describing sounds like an explosion, not jet fuel dripping down elevator shafts, as stated in the official version. Why did so many people hear an explosion below ground? A collision above might crack or break some windows, but I didn't understand how that could tear up the lobby. Especially when you consider the base of the building would have felt the least amount of vibration as the shockwave was absorbed by the 95 floors above it. Remember, these images are from before the second plane strike, meaning these images were recorded between 8:46 and 9:03 a.m. The only thing that had happened so far is a plane impact around the 95th floor of this building.
Right away, a guy from the Port Authority told him the damage is somewhere above the 78th floor. But all you had to do was look around. It was obvious. Something had happened right there in the lobby.
FDNY fireman John Schrader, whose engine company 10 is across the street from the Trade Center complex, arrived at the first tower hit, the North Tower, within 10 minutes of the impact.
We came down, it looked like a bomb went off in the lobby. You know, something, it wasn't from the jet fuel. No way.
The ladies that are with me were in the World Trade Center in the first building and escaped through the lobby, where they report they believe there was a bomb in the lobby.
The bomb hit the lobby first, and a couple of seconds in the first plane hit.
I mean, I know people that got killed in the basement. I know people that got broken legs in the basement. People that got reconstructive surgery because the walls hit them in the face.
At the time, I was actually in the subway heading towards the World Trade Center right around Franklin Street. And after the first explosion, the subway station started to fill with smoke. The subway cars started to fill with smoke, and the subways actually stopped.
With so many people talking about the explosions at street level, it would make sense that early reports had the FBI and others looking into bombs at the base of the buildings.
Apparently what appears to happen was that at the same time two planes hit the building, that the FBI most likely thinks that there was a car or truck packed with explosives underneath the buildings, which also exploded at the same time and brought both of them down.
Reason to believe that one of the explosions at the World Trade Center may have been caused by a van that was parked in the building that may have had some type of explosive device in it.
I spoke to the chief of safety for the New York City Fire Department. He received word of the possibility of a secondary device, that is another bomb going off. There was another explosion which took place. According to his theory, he thinks that there were actually devices that were planted in the building.
Jenny Carr was recording a business meeting near the Trade Center at 8:46 a.m. on 9/11 when we hear the basement explosion. 9 seconds later, we can hear the first plane hitting the North Tower.
A bomb went off in the lobby first, then a plane hit the building, but then another plane hit the other building.
Let's discuss these pre-collapse pops. From a distance, they sound like pops, but they're actually pretty powerful. Hundreds of secondary explosions were reported at various times prior to the collapse of all three buildings. In a controlled demolition, these bangs are shaped charge explosive, blowing out beams before a collapse. They can be programmed to go off hours or seconds before an implosion. These were mostly reported as secondary explosions by the first responders and reporters.
We've heard reports of secondary explosions after the aircraft impact.
Then somebody said that they saw an airliner going to one of those towers. Then, an hour later than that, we had that big explosion from much, much lower. I don't know what on earth caused that.
Here, hold on. You want to call your mother or something?
The final booms and crackle are like the grand finale of a fireworks show. In a controlled demolition, the vast majority of the explosives are set to go off in an ordered fashion over the span of a few seconds as the building collapses. Depending on distance, this can sound like a rumble, booms, or crackling.
That feeling that there was something else, that there may have been something else that brought those buildings down.
There was a lot of talk there in New York of another explosion prior to the collapse of the first building.
We could hear a rumble, which was about 5 seconds long, preceding the actual collapse, and then a boom when each of those towers collapsed.
In this footage, which has been slowed, you can see white smoke emanating from the ground floor before the collapse wave arrives. It's an unsteady camera, but keep in mind whoever recorded this was running for their life. It was like watching a stunt car explode before it crashes at the bottom of the cliff. In this image, recently released by a Freedom of Information Act request, police department photographer captured an explosion originating at the base of the South Tower, just before the first tower collapsed. The explosions and shockwave before Building 7's collapse were captured in different ways.
We're watching the building actually because it was on fire. The bottom floors of the building were on fire, and we heard this sound that sounded like a clap of thunder. Turned around, we were shocked to see that the building was it looked like there was a shockwave ripping through the building, and the windows all busted out.
In the end, the evidence of explosions was ignored by the organizations behind the official version, like NIST, FEMA, Popular Mechanics, and the 9/11 Commission. My independent search continued. Up next, the kink in the roof. It's not necessary for there to be a kink in the roof of an imploding building, but when it does happen, it's a pretty sure indication of a controlled demolition. The roof can only kink in when the central support columns are blown out first, meaning the destruction of the building is coming from inside it, not outside. This is done by design so the building falls in on itself. The kink in Building 7 is clearly visible to the naked eye. Controlled demolitions are designed to let the top of the building fall through its inner core columns, which is typically the strongest part of any building. Watch the penthouse of Building 7 sink into the floor below it just before the collapse begins. Squibs. Squibs are the sixth indicator on our list. In demolition vernacular, squibs refer to visible blasts from explosive charges. Often they are visible through mistiming or malfunction in some way. Usually they are hidden in the debris cloud. In simple terms, squibs are visual evidence of explosives. Squibs were recorded from the moment of the first plane impact through the collapse of the last tower. For me, they went unnoticed until I looked at the video more closely. These stills captured squibs as the towers collapsed. The official version stated these squibs were compressed air caused by the pancaking floors, which squeezed air to the point of bursting out a window. The seal of the building was already broken when the collapse began. Logically, if it was compressed air, it should have found the path of least resistance through the broken part of the building. It shouldn't have knocked out a window here or a window there, as many as 40 floors below the blast wave.
Naysayers tend to say, well, that's just air being blown out the windows. I mean, it doesn't really work to say it's just air pressure. And I estimated these are coming out faster than 100 miles an hour.
The following clips show multiple squibs popping out, sometimes simultaneously, sometimes dozens of floors away from each other. Of all the 9/11 information I've come across, this may have been the easiest to spot. Yet it provided me with one of those stark moments in which the reality of 9/11 sunk in to a new level. In this clip, notice how the squib occurs before the floors above reach the blast ejection point. Not all squibs, however, were easy to spot. Remember how we discussed explosions that were timed to go off with the plane impacts? Well, this is the first plane impact. Notice the dark brown smoke coming out of the top floor of the tower. This smoke is already dissipating before the plane strikes the building. In this segment, the NBC camera is pointed at the North Tower, the first tower hit. In a few seconds, the second tower is going to be hit. You'll know it when it happens because of the reporter's voice and the fireball in the lower left corner of the screen. Now keep your eye on the east facade, the one on the left. Notice how several tiny explosions go off as the second plane hits, the other building, perhaps in an effort to mask some necessary work prior to its demolition, as I was thinking at the time.
Oh, another one just hit. Something else just hit.
The seventh characteristic of a planned implosion is what's called a demolition wave. It's the path of destruction in a controlled demolition. It is a visible wave of explosions moving down the columns of a building just ahead of or at the speed of gravity. This array of synchronized explosives is timed to blow out floors beneath the collapse wave as the floors above reach the floors below, thus allowing a drop at approaching freefall speed. Again, let's slow down the film for some of these. When slowed down, you can see how the explosions are timed to go off, floor by floor. In this clip, you can clearly see a demolition wave proceeding down a column mostly hidden by the umbrella of the falling debris pile. Look to the right of the black line. It's a bit grainy because of the zoom. Here it is again without the black line. You can see synced explosives cutting a path down the building. The demolition wave can be hard to see with an untrained eye because it happens so fast. I tried to highlight a few more examples in the following clips. Often buildings being demolished will have a mesh around them to keep projectiles from shooting away. In the case of the Twin Towers, there were thousands of pieces of steel jettisoned out much further than they could have if it were a gravitational collapse. Some pieces were ejected laterally over 600 feet. Some of these pieces weighed several tons. Let's listen to what a few experts had to say on the topic.
Window mullions and things went up and out. That kind of stuff can't happen with just pure air pressure of floors getting sandwiched together.
Large, multi-ton beams were hurled hundreds of yards laterally. Gravity works vertically, not laterally.
The fragments which are being, which is coming out of the tower, obviously being kicked out by an explosive action.
And here it is trailing white smoke the whole time. It really is indicative of some kind of explosion.
I'm no physicist, but if this was a gravitational collapse, there is no way that multi-ton beams can land 2 football fields away. I've lived in high-rises my whole life, and I've dropped things off my balcony, things like shoes and computer monitors. All they do is fall straight down. Even aerodynamic items like plates never ended up across the street. In some of these clips, you can see projectiles actually propelled upward, forming an arc. If this were a gravitational collapse, pieces could not be shot upward. And consider the pieces we see. The small pieces weigh a few pounds and the biggest pieces weigh several tons. In this clip, a multi-ton steel box column had so much lateral force that it pierced the building across the street. To give you an idea of its size, here you can see a construction worker standing at the base of the box column being installed. If I can't chuck a shoe more than 150 feet from the 50th floor of my building, how much force do you need to get a multi-ton steel girder to triple that? I could pretty much rule out a gravitational or progressive collapse with the physical dynamics I'd seen with my own eyes. And I found it ironic that the only part left standing was the base of the building. Even though the whole building landed on it, it was the only part of the building whose columns did not become dismembered. Perhaps that says something about the difficulty in wiring the atrium of the towers. And maybe these columns at the base did what the rest of the building should have done, and that is stay together in some way. Just a personal observation I'd made at the time. Of course I've been wondering how the hijackers wired the buildings. It was the only thing that still made any sense, even if barely. But I stopped wondering how the hijackers did it when I learned what was found in the Ground Zero dust. Even though the cleanup and removal of the Ground Zero evidence began within hours of the attacks, not all of it was removed. Many different dust samples were analyzed by scientists all over the world, and what they concluded put the final nail in the coffin of the official story for me. We touched on thermite earlier, but we're going to look into it more deeply for reasons you'll soon understand. Thermite is a chemical mixture, usually of metal oxide and aluminum powder, with several variations. It's often used in fireworks, underwater welding, and military weapons. It can also be used to cut steel beams. When thermite is detonated, it leaves traces of itself in the debris, like perfectly round microscopic spheres of iron, and unexploded thermite itself, both of which were found in the Ground Zero dust. The fact that explosive residue was found in the dust didn't surprise me, at least not by now. I already knew in my heart it was a controlled demolition. What rocked me was the type of thermite found. You see, it was a special type of thermite called nanothermite, and it meant that the odds that the hijackers could have done this dropped to near zero. My belief system kept taking more hits, which we'll discuss in a bit. For now, though, let's have the experts walk us through the basics.
In 3 different samples from 3 independent researchers, the R.J. Lee Company, the USGS, and Dr. Stephen Jones's work, all 3 separately found these microspheres.
As much as 6% of the World Trade Center dust consisted of tiny, previously molten iron spheres.
You cannot get a perfectly round sphere of metal from the building tearing apart. The only way you can get that is by starting with a molten liquid. Then the hydrostatic pressure will create the perfectly round sphere as it solidifies.
So what produced all that molten iron? Well, it has in it the chemical evidence of a special incendiary, which is thermite, a high-tech incendiary used to cut through steel like
you
a hot knife through
that?
Butter. These spheres have iron, aluminum, fluorine, manganese, very unusual elements associated only with thermite. And there's small chips of unignited thermite as well.
In the dust, we found what we characterize as unreacted thermitic material in the shape of some very tiny red gray chips.
We captured the residue after the material had been heated. The red gray chips, as we ignite them, produce spheres that have iron and aluminum, just like we see in the dust in abundance.
And the composition was very, very similar.
And that led to the conclusion of the paper, which was, we've got some form of thermite in these red gray chips.
What I can confirm also is that these chips, the red layer is thermitic. It does produce molten iron.
I've heard this argument that somehow perhaps someone seeded these samples with nanothermite.
There have been some that have argued that these red gray chips could be paint of some form.
I've also heard the argument that perhaps the falling buildings just generated this nanothermite. Well, no.
So it wasn't, the red gray chips are not the primer paint that was used on the WTC steel.
These chips are not naturally occurring. They are not going to form because some materials fall down in a building and touch each other and get compressed together. That's just not what this material is.
What we have found is a modern version of thermite, which we call nanothermite, which is produced in a different way. It is not just two powders being mixed.
First of all, the iron oxide grains are uniform and approximately 100 nanometers across. That's very tiny, much smaller than a human hair. The aluminum occurs in plates that are about 40 nanometers across. I have no idea how to make those. I mean, this is a high-tech material, and it's embedded in a carbon-rich matrix with order. These red-gray materials have very orderly sheets containing aluminum.
This is a material that is made up of nano-sized particles that are all very uniform, very symmetrical.
The aluminum appears in thin platelets about 40 nanometers thick. It is the small size of the particles involved in this material that allow us to characterize it as nanothermite.
These really are sophisticated materials and probably only developed in a laboratory.
This is very high-tech thermite, nanothermite. It's not found in a cave in Afghanistan. It's produced in very sophisticated Defense Department contracting laboratories.
We compared our spike that we got with a spike from known nanothermite, which is produced at a military laboratory. Their measured energy released with known nanothermite was less than these red gray chips.
What we are dealing with, I think, in World Trade Center is modern military material which is unknown to the general public.
It takes steel and it creates molten steel. So it takes beams of steel and it turns it into molten steel. And it just rot, everything underneath just sinks into the ground like what you saw. And it is a special US military grade weapon.
So the military uses it for a number of different applications.
Okay. It is a military grade weapon. It's not something you could make ever.
I was pretty astonished at how deep this rabbit hole was getting, even though I still had no idea what I was in for. Of course, by now, I had to acknowledge this was a planned demolition, unless I wanted to lie to myself. Maybe you can explain squibs, but how do you explain explosions or the molten steel? And if you explain that, how do you explain the rate of fall or thermite in the dust? I had to face facts. No matter what my heart wanted to believe, these buildings were wired to blow, plain and simple. But it wasn't until understanding how nanothermite is made and who has it that I considered, for the first time, that someone other than the hijackers had to be involved. And as scary as it was to consider, it might even be homegrown. Hundreds of questions kept flooding in. Why would underfunded guys on the other side of the world use something so exotic as nanothermite that could easily be tracked by our intelligence services? Who would sell it or make it for them? Why risk accessing the buildings every day for months? How did Building 7 get detonated at the end of the day? If you have the means and go to the trouble of getting nanothermite and wiring the building, why let the plan rest on using box cutters to overthrow military and combat-trained airline pilots, along with dozens of passengers, as the official version states? Heck, why bother killing yourself in a plane crash at all if it wasn't needed to take the buildings down? I had no idea what I was staring at, at least not yet. but a few puzzle pieces had been filled in. I knew that the buildings were brought down by controlled demolition, military thermite was used, NIST was being used to sell a lie, and someone wanted us to think that planes had caused this. I kept replaying the event in my head, over and over, assimilating each new piece of information as I discovered it. And like a retreating army, my line in the sand about what could have really happened kept moving further and further back, and getting closer to home. But I was on a mission, and I was obsessed to find out the truth. Researching late every night was disrupting my home life again, and my wife still didn't see eye to eye with me about 9/11. Back then, she still believed the official version, but she hadn't seen what I had. For a time, she even thought I was losing it. For a time, I wondered it myself, because I was coming across things I had a hard time believing. My former dismissive, conventional thinking self was fading away as my eyes continued to open, causing changes in my belief system and further destabilizing our home. It was harder than ever to drop the subject. Rifts were developing in other relationships too. I was angry at everything and everyone, from God to the government to anyone that didn't want to hear or believe what I had to say. I became a bit reclusive as I dug deeper. If the building was wired, lots of people had to get past security every day for a while. Remember when I said I lived in high-rises my whole life? Well, I worked in them too. And there is no way you can access buildings like those without the building security knowing. Lots of equipment had to be brought in. Authorization forms would need to be filled out. There would be drilling and pounding and dust in the ventilation ducts. Whoever was coming in would need a plausible reason to be there. They would need access to the elevator shafts. They would be taking incredible risks each day, unless they had permission to access the guts of the building.
Anybody who's ever watched a building being demolished on purpose knows that if you're going to do this, you have to get at the under infrastructure of a building and bring it down.
The columns could have been set up with explosive devices during the off-hour operations of the building by elevator company personnel.
It wouldn't be a problem once you gained access to the elevator shafts.
How about an elevator modernization, which we know was going on the 9 months prior to 9/11? There are people who noted that the elevators were locked in turn and that there were guards placed at these locked elevators during the modernization.
And in the case of a steel frame building, that means we load them with RDX cutting charges, which are loaded with individual delays, sometimes as many as 2 to 3 different delays on a given floor.
I was sick to death of the dust which was appearing on the windowsills. It was dirty gray and very, very noticeable in that week leading up to 9/11.
There were workers throughout the World Trade Center and it had access to the hoistway, which is immediately adjacent to the core columns and beams in the building.
The fact that there were visitors, like engineers of some kind, wandering around the floors, carrying toolboxes and cables and so on.
We're talking about several tons of nanothermite and ordinary thermite. One would have to have access through security.
The video cameras caught trucks arriving at the World Trade Center from about August 23rd until every night until about September 2nd, September 3rd. And the trucks were arriving at about 3 o'clock in the morning when everybody else had left the building, including the janitorial trucks. Something was brought into that building that would help with the detonation. There may have been work done on the detonation before. It may have been going on for months, but whatever they needed at the very end, they came and brought in that 10-day period.
The 9/11 Commission also does not tell you that Marvin Bush, the president's brother, and their cousin, Ward Walker, were the principals of the company that was in charge of security for the World Trade Center. They don't, man, yeah.
The jaw-dropping coincidences kept piling up. I learned that Stratasec was a security company which used to be called Securecom, and they didn't just handle security for the World Trade Center complex. They had contracts with Dulles International Airport, from where Flight 93 departed, and United Airlines, accounting for most of the security breakdowns on 9/11. And another thing, Stratasec also handles security for Los Alamos National Labs, one of the only places on the planet that can produce the nanothermite found in the Ground Zero dust. The odds are pretty astonishing that one company can link so many vital elements of 9/11. But more astonishing is there's no mention of Stratasec or Securicom in the entire 567-page 9/11 Commission report. Of course, that was no surprise by now. Did I forget to mention that that same 9/11 Commission did not mention the collapse of Building 7 in the entire report either?
Why is there not a word about the collapse of that building in the 9/11 Commission report?
We didn't see any evidence of the kind of thing you're talking about.
I didn't think this was something done by terrorists anymore. Nor did I think this was done by any one man, even if a president. How does he get nanothermite? How does he get NORAD, the FAA, and our air defenses to look the other way? Or get access to the interior of all three towers? Or get 19 guys to kill themselves? Or get NIST and the 9/11 Commission to tank their investigations? Or keep the media quiet? Or keep a rival administration from exposing it? No, this seemed much bigger than even a president, and impossible for a man on the run. If someone like me, with no budget or staff, can find something clearly wrong with Building 7's collapse, how could an entire government commission fail to mention it in their report? Something big and strange was coming into view, seemingly coordinated and almost invisible, like 1,000 more puzzle pieces dumped out before me. I couldn't see the bigger picture yet, but I knew there was one, and it involved powerful elements of our world. This reminded me of a quote that struck me in Woodrow Wilson's book, The New Freedom. He writes, "Some of the biggest men in the United States in the field of commerce and manufacture are afraid of somebody, are afraid of something. They know that there is a power somewhere so organized, so subtle, so watchful, so interlocked, so complete, so pervasive, that they had better not speak above their breath when they speak in condemnation of it." I wondered if we were talking about the same thing, so I continued my research. I didn't even need to remind myself I was falling down the rabbit hole anymore. I was now fully expecting to see the unexpected. Remember the opening chapter, The Dog That Didn't Bark? It was a reference to a Sherlock Holmes story called Silver Blaze, in which Holmes deduces the culprit must have known the family dog, because the dog didn't bark while the crime was committed, as he normally would if a stranger were on the property. The same way the Secret Service didn't bark, by staying in the school. The same way real watchdogs like the 9/11 Commission, NIST, and the media didn't bark either. Lots of people, including politicians, the media, and emergency workers on the ground, knew Building 7 was going to come down well ahead of time, as impossible an event as that was.
But even then, they said, hey, you know, like, you got to stay behind this line because they're thinking about taking this building down. They're not sure if it's stable or not. So they were holding a line off because they had knowledge that something was going to happen.
That by noon or 1 o'clock, they told us we had to move from that triage site up to Pace University, a little further away, because Building 7 was going to come down or being brought down.
Did they actually use the word brought down, and who was it that was telling you this?
The fire department, and they did use the word, we're going to have to bring it down.
Keep your eye on that building, it'll be coming down soon.
I didn't hear any creaking, or I didn't hear any indication that it was going to come down. And all of a sudden, the radios exploded, and everybody started screaming, get away from it. And the whole time, you hear them, thoom, 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 thoom. So, I think I know an explosion when I hear it.
We are on the phone with New York Fire Department Lieutenant David Restuccio. Can you confirm it was number 7 that just went in?
Yes, sir.
And you guys knew this was coming all day.
We had heard reports that the building was unstable and that it eventually would either come down on its own or it would be taken down.
And we were in a building in which we were trapped for about 10-15 minutes, and we set up headquarters at 75 Barclay Street, which was right there with the police commissioner, the fire commissioner, the head of emergency management, and we were operating out of there when we were told that the World Trade Center was going to collapse. The World Trade Center was going to collapse. It was going to collapse. It was going to collapse.
But it was the media's pre-knowledge of Building 7's fall that was much more telling. Several news outlets around the world reported the collapse of Building 7 long before it happened. I listened closely to these segments. considering Building 7 wasn't hit by an airplane and no high-rise has ever collapsed because of fire, how was it that all these different news agencies reported it before it happened? How can anyone report there has been an improbable accident before the accident happens?
Now, more on the latest building collapse in New York. You might have heard a few moments ago, I was talking about the Salomon Brothers building collapsing, and indeed it has. Apparently that's only a few hundred yards away from where the World Trade Center towers were.
That one of the other buildings, Building 7, in the World Trade Center complex is on fire and has either collapsed or is collapsing.
That has structural damage as well. We saw a lot of glass broken out and a corner of the building appeared to be in distress, and there's concern that there might actually be another collapse of that building.
We are getting word from New York right now that another building has collapsed. Is that smoke coming from this third collapse? Okay, that is what we're understanding, which makes sense because it looks like the sun is going down. But I'm hoping that enough people have cleared out of downtown Manhattan so that perhaps it wasn't as full as it might be normally around 5:30 on a Tuesday.
That information, of course, take a look at that right-hand side of the screen.
It's going down right now.
There it is.
Yep.
It went down.
Brown building, the tall one, is number 7 World Trade Center. Heard several reports from several different officers now that that is the building that is going to go down next.
The media has played an important role in shaping the official story, even to this day. The idea that the buildings fell because of planes and fire was instilled in the public's conscience early and often on 9/11, and it started before any buildings fell.
And that perhaps they're buckling under the force of the collision or the hole that's resulted from these two planes.
My sense is that just one, the velocity of the plane and the fact that there were, you have a plane filled with fuel hitting that building that burned.
So structural damage, as you had suggested, probably led to this building going down.
We are seeing it was because the building had been weakened during this morning's attacks.
And then I witnessed both towers collapse, one first and then the second, mostly due to structural failure because the fire was just too intense.
And now we are told that there's a fire there and that building may collapse as well, as you can.
Pictures of airplanes flying into buildings, fires burning, huge structures collapsing, have filled us with disbelief.
Metaphor time. Let's say your local TV news breaks in with a report of a car accident at the corner of Main and First Avenue because a car blew out a tire, swerved into a tanker truck, and it exploded. Now, your office is at that corner, so you go out and look, but everything looks fine. You flip stations and other stations are reporting it too, using different wire services even. As you stare out the window wondering where there's another Main and First Avenue, a car drives into a parked gas truck and it explodes. Have you witnessed a miracle or a staged event? If what I was finding were mistakes in a massive ruse, then the sheer boldness and size of it alone is why I never saw it before. It reminded me of a quote often attributed to Joseph Goebbels, the minister of propaganda for Hitler's Nazi Germany, who stated that, "If you tell a lie big enough and keep repeating it, people will eventually come to believe it." I found a pattern of bullying, intimidation, belittling of anyone asking valid questions, which did nothing to soften my growing anger, even though I had no idea to where or to whom it was directed.
We're not buying it.
Okay, you don't have to buy anything. You're American. You want to be a nut, you can be a nut.
Anybody who thinks that 9/11 was carried out by the government isn't a truther. They're idiots.
I'm merely saying it is wrong, blasphemous, and sinful for you to suggest, imply, or help other people come to the conclusion that the U.S. government killed 3,000 of its own citizens, because it didn't.
How big a lunatic do you have to be to watch two giant airliners packed with jet fuel slam into buildings on live TV, igniting a massive inferno that burned for 2 hours, and then think, well, if you believe that was the cause?
These people are idiots. They're mentally ill. They should be treated with respect. It's an insult to people who were victims of 9/11 and their families.
You know what? It wasn't an inside job. We can see the planes. The planes hit the building. It wasn't a controlled demolition, and the buildings came down. And it just is beyond bizarre.
Yeah, and you are a nutcase, Building 7.
9/11 was an inside job. Oh, get a life. Get a life. 9/11 was an inside job.
You're like the guys who think that the space aliens kidnapped Elvis or something like that. That's where you are.
I didn't think it was an accident that every question is uniformly dismissed. I couldn't find a familiar journalist that seriously entertained these obvious questions, that anyone would have. Could I really be on to something that the media couldn't see? Or were they trying to keep me from seeing something they did? Most reasonable people would question the official story after seeing what we've seen. So I switched my focus to independent news sources, outside the mainstream. No, they're not well-funded, slick, or glitzy. Most are just regular people or sincere journalists trying to expose the truth about something in their corner of the world. One such man was Bill Cooper. I found him early in my 9/11 research. At the time, I couldn't explain how he predicted what you're about to hear. Bill Cooper spent his life in the intelligence community. He rose to the Office of Naval Security and Intelligence, serving on the intelligence briefing team for the Commander-in-Chief of the Pacific Fleet. He held several top security clearances. After the military, he developed and operated the largest civilian intelligence agency in the world.
The world's largest and most successful civilian intelligence gathering operation in the world, which makes me privy to an awful lot of information that none of you will ever see.
In other words, he was very credible. The following clip is from his radio program, The Hour of the Time, which aired on the night of June 28, 2001. 76 days before 9/11 happened.
A CNN reporter found Osama bin Laden, took a television camera crew with him, went into Osama bin Laden's hideout, interviewed him and his top leadership, his top lieutenants and colonels and generals, in their hideout. This is a CNN reporter with a camera crew. And he came out and told everybody, within 3 weeks, Osama bin Laden is going to attack the United States and Israel. Now, don't you think that's kind of strange, folks? You see, because the largest intelligence apparatus in the world, with the biggest budget in the history of the world, has been looking for Osama bin Laden for years and years and years and can't find him. And whatever is going to happen that they're going to blame on Osama bin Laden, don't you even believe it. When in hell are all you people going to wake up?
All these early news reports were glaring misfires in what seemed to be an otherwise coordinated media campaign. Misfires not unlike the ones meant to coincide with the first plane impact. Little mistakes that my untrained eye never picked up before, but that I was now finding all over, spawning even more questions, and fueling the early stages of what would become my spiritual awakening. As I continued finding evidence leading me away from the official version, it was not surprising the main body of evidence was being removed within hours of the attacks, cleaning up a crime scene with no real investigation.
Because what they did immediately after 9/11 was they started removing the debris from Tower 7 and all the towers immediately.
400 truckloads per day of material were taken away from the World Trade Center site and sent to China for recycling.
There were laws violated in the destruction of that evidence.
I was starting to believe that things like the immediate cleanup were probably no accident. And to discover what was really happening, I'd need to find the ones behind the cleanup and the coordinated media and NIST and FEMA, the Federal Emergency Management Agency, which in another huge coincidence, arrived at New York for a training exercise on Monday, September 10th, the night before 9/11. Which is convenient, as they oversaw the cleanup of Ground Zero.
To be honest with you, we arrived on late Monday night and went into action on Tuesday morning. And not until today did we get a full opportunity to work.
Over time, it got easier to find puzzle pieces, like the following testimony by Norman Mineta, the Secretary of Transportation in 2001, who was with Vice President Dick Cheney on the morning of 9/11. And like so much other important information, this interview would also be left out of the 9/11 Commission report.
During the time that the airplane coming in to the Pentagon, there was a young man who would come in and say to the vice president, the plane is 50 miles out. The plane is 30 miles out. And when it got down to the plane is 10 miles out, the young man also said to the vice president, do the orders still stand? And the vice president turned and whipped his neck around and said, of course the orders still stand. Have you heard anything to the contrary? Well, at the time, I didn't know what all that meant. And
the flight you're referring to is the
flight that came into the Pentagon.
The Mineta testimony launched my investigation into the Pentagon, Shanksville, the hijackers, and many other aspects of 9/11. And if I thought I was a long way down the rabbit hole already, was I way wrong? My belief system would ultimately be shattered, but rebuilt to accommodate my evolving worldview. Back then, however, I was only a few months into my investigation, and I was going through a full scope of emotions, and frankly, having a difficult time handling all of them. Denial, curiosity, fear, disbelief, paranoia, anger, and heartbreak. And I would go through many more. I was still unable to reconcile all the data in front of me. I couldn't see the bigger picture at the time. But like the wind, it can't be seen, yet we know it's there because it leaves evidence of its existence. Very much like the trail of breadcrumbs I'd been researching over the last few months. But it's not something I could understand in one sitting. It took time. Coping with the flood of emotions took a while. I didn't have anyone guiding me or anyone to talk to about it. I felt like I had no foundation, like the ground was crumbling beneath me. The truth is hidden by several mechanisms, especially the limits of our own preconceived beliefs. I'd been so ignorant and dismissive, but now I wondered what else I'd been fooled about. Over the years, I came to see that we're in a battle of information, a battle of beliefs, or a spiritual battle, if you will. I also came to believe that 9/11 is only one battle in a much larger war, a war I couldn't see yet, but one that I was well on the way to discovering. This is a lot to take in, and we all wake up at our own speed, if at all, which is why I stopped after only looking at the Trade Center portion of the attacks. There is so much more to this, but it's easier to process in smaller chunks. Betsy and I woke up at different speeds. My eyes started opening pretty quickly, but it took Betsy a few years, even though we talked about it all the time. It wasn't until she watched early versions of this movie that she began to believe me. I clearly remember the day in June of 2013 when she came voluntarily and shared her own thoughts about her own 9/11 research, something she'd never done before. And I knew by talking to her that her eyes were finally opening too. It probably saved our marriage. Getting past that stumbling block opened the door for us to reconnect. If there's a pit in your stomach, don't be overwhelmed or scared. Whatever's behind all of this has been there for a long time, and I'm sure you've lived, loved, and laughed in that time. And you still will. The shock will wear off, and what will be left is a much better understanding of how the world works, which makes the bad guys' jobs harder. Over time, the discomfort and confusion subsided, and I went back to my life, with clarity and new hope for what's ahead. Today, I'm able to laugh and be happy and look forward to the future like everyone else. I have all that, and I'm more aware of important things happening around me. So if you want to forget everything you've seen, go back to your regular life. Soon you'll forget about all of this. Our defense mechanisms work that way. But if you decide to jump down the rabbit hole, my advice is to seek your own answers, do your own research, and don't let anyone tell you what to believe about anything. Because until you see it for yourself, it'll be hard to ever understand why it's so important to know it exists.